So as a big Disney fan, I was really excited when I heard that Disney's Wish would have a more traditional Disney villain. Because even though we've gotten, say, Shiny, for example, from Moana, after that, I can't really think of any movie that has a more traditional villain like Dr. Facilier and Scar and Ursula. Frozen 1 obviously had a twist villain, and so Hans did not get a villain song. Frozen 2 had more of a person versus self, person versus nature, person versus environment conflict. In Canto, Abuela is the antagonist, but she's not a villain, and the list goes on. And so, even in Moana, if you kind of don't count Tamatoa because he was sort of like a stop on the road map as opposed to the destination, you know what I mean? And so I was really excited when I heard that the villain from Wish would have a villain song. The internet was excited. I think a lot of people thought that this was going to be a return to form, that this was going to slap, that finally we would have a traditional villain song. And I was super happy. And then I listened to it. Good day, everybody. It is Calxiyn here to rant on Calxiyn Cares Too Much, where we talk about things that I care about way too much. I don't know if anybody else is as incensed by this as I am, but like the Twitter reaction was mixed, to say the least. So I don't think it's just me. I think that there are a lot of people that feel this way. The complaints basically range to this isn't a traditional Disney villain number in terms of the tone. I'll talk about that. I'm not sure how valid that is, but again, that was a big thing. Blaming Lin-Manuel Miranda for the downfall of society, and that it sounds like more of an Imagine Dragons or pop song, which I think was the biggest criticism. And because of these reactions, I wanted to air out my frustrations, but also give some insight because I am a musical theater performing arts graduate who was taught to and has co-written Broadway-style music before. And I will say, especially as a musical theater performer, I cannot help but feel a little annoyed here because Broadway talent saved Disney animation. If you don't know, like, Disney was basically on the verge of bankruptcy before they made The Little Mermaid. It was the Broadway talent. It was Howard Ashman and Alan Menken who basically saved the company. And so instead of hiring Broadway talent for this project, they hired pop artists to do the music. And that has me a little bit annoyed. This movie has been marketed to celebrate Disney. Like, it's about wishes and dreams, like for the 100th anniversary. And Asha is based on Snow White and her friends are based on the Seven Dwarfs. And she also has the color scheme of the fairy godmother. Like, there's a bunch of references to Disney classic movies in here. It's kind of this big hurrah. Like, there's the 3D style mixed in with the 2D. There is old, there is new. But how can you do a celebration like that in a movie without the people from the profession that made Disney music iconic in the first place? And listen, I don't want to be blacklisted, so I'll preface this by saying I'm not trying to be disrespectful in any way. I'm not saying that the music is horrible, but musical, or the musical, is a medium, is a method of delivery, but it's also a style. And so Wish may be a musical in terms of the medium, that is how they are delivering the story, just like how animation is not a genre, it's a medium, right? Animation is the way to deliver the story, so is a musical. They're not a genre. But stylistically, I see three key reasons why this song is not hitting, why so many people are complaining, and I think it's at least worth discussing why people are having such a poor reaction to the number. I actually want to start with the Lin-Manuel Miranda thing because it goes into what I'm gonna say about the instrumentation. Not to be vulgar, but I am not a Lin-Manuel Miranda dick rider, okay? Like, I understand why people don't like him. I like his music personally, but I'm not here to lick his boots. However, saying the song sounds similar to You're Welcome and chalking the poor quality up to trying to mimic his style, I feel like that's a surface level reaction because if anything, you could say that they're trying to copy his style without his skill, but I don't think that this is actually in his composition style at all. Okay, so let's take a listen to You're Welcome, and I'm actually gonna stay on screen here because I feel like that, you know, I don't wanna call it conducting, but I find personally when I'm listening to something, I can hear the instruments better if I make sort of a hand movement or see someone else make a hand movement that corresponds with the instrument that I'm talking about. You can hear it, but it's also maybe helped some people if it's visual as well. So let's just get started right now, okay? So obviously you hear the percussion. There was a strum of a harp right there, so let's go back and listen to that again, like this. And there's also a little twinkle in there, listen to this. Yeah, I think it was right there. The ding, right? It may be a glockenspiel or something similar. Instrument identification is not, you know, my strong suit. It's probably my weakest area. Let me know, correct me if I'm wrong on any of that sort of stuff. After that, right, even in the rap section, we have a lot of brass instrument and we also have a string section, right? So let's listen to this. Okay, that was more me head bopping to the brass, but you can hear the violin. Yeah, and you can hear the brass really go do-do-do-do-do-do, right? And so we have a lot of different instruments going on in there. And I do all this because Lin incorporates modern elements with Broadway orchestration. Like, yeah, Maui is rapping, but usually in a rap song, you wouldn't have, you know, the brass section, like, popping off like that, right? And so when people heard this song, they think Lin-Manuel Miranda, because that's their only sort of, you know, their only sort of basis, or, like, that's the first thing they think of in terms of modern Disney music, right? But listening to this song, listening to This Is the Thanks I Get, we'll see what's in here. It's not a lot. So obviously you can hear the percussion, you can hear the bass guitar. I took out the guy's voice. I took out the singer's voice so we could listen to this a little bit better. This is where the synth comes in. There it is, it's right there. So that's pretty much all we got. We got percussion, a bass guitar, my mom told me, and a synth in the background. And when the chorus like comes in, I sort of lose keeping track, but I don't really think that there's anything else going on in this song. There's no brass, at least not that I can find. There is no brass. There are strings later on, so let's go ahead and listen to that together. Okay, so I really like string instruments, so maybe it's just me, but to me, that's where the song gets interesting, is the string instruments. But the reason why I'm pointing this out is because this is more like a traditional band compared to a Broadway orchestra. For most of the song, there is no strings. There's guitar, there's drums, and then there's the singer. And there's that lack of traditional instruments that make up a Broadway orchestra, and there's no sense that the songwriters wanted to mix Broadway elements with modern music. It reads more as a pop song. Honestly, no slander, it reminds me of How Bad Can I Be from the Lorax, which, like, it's, you know, good for what it is, right? Like, that song, I know people like it, I know it's a bop, but that style of music is not associated with Disney. Usually it's associated with DreamWorks or Universal more, especially because, you know, there's some composer overlap. It feels like the original pop song inserted in Despicable Me. That's kind of the vibe. So I think Lin-Manuel Miranda slander aside, that brings us to why it doesn't sound like a traditional villain song. Broadway composers Alan Menken and Howard Ashman working on Aladdin, Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, save Disney, again, let me just say, from bankruptcy. And even people after, like Christian Anderson Lopez and Robert Lopez, who wrote the music for Frozen, they have Broadway roots as well. And as far as I can tell, researching the pop artists writing the music for Wish, they don't. But they don't. There are no Broadway credits. They haven't worked on a Broadway show. They haven't done, like, even a Broadway concept album. And lots of Disney movies break this tradition. Tarzan, for example. And I'll bring this up later because I actually have more of a list than just Tarzan. But Tarzan does this, right? But I wouldn't call Tarzan a musical. I would say that Tarzan is a movie that has music in it. The characters aren't the ones singing, except for, like, the, you know, the thing at the camp, right? But, like, that's the exception. There's music that the singer is, like, singing over the story. And that's kind of where this is sort of, like, I know that the king is singing, but it's closer to that, to me, than an actual musical theater song. And so one of the reasons why it doesn't sound like a traditional villain song, it doesn't really have anything to do with tone. You know, Gaston is an upbeat Disney villain song. I don't think it's valid to be like, oh, it has to be dark and spooky, you know, for it to be a valid Disney villain song, because Gaston isn't like that. But but it doesn't utilize any of the Broadway influences that Disney music is loved for having. I'm also, again, gonna throw this out there that Broadway has a lot of roots in jazz, right? They have a very intertwined history together. And there is no brass. There's absolutely no brass. Mother Knows Best has brass. Gaston has brass. Be Prepared even has brass. I was like, going into Be Prepared, I was like, I don't know, like maybe that's the one that doesn't, right? Poor Unfortunate Souls, you don't even need me to tell you, right? That is a brass based economy, Poor Unfortunate Souls. The only villain song I can think of that doesn't have a brass section maybe is Hellfire. That's because they're trying to mimic traditional mass music. And Hellfire, I think, is a great example because I do not want you to walk away from this video thinking that Broadway music is about the instruments you have in the pit. It's not. You can still have a pop rock musical and still have it be a musical. So what is wrong, if you want to say wrong, or why do I think that this song does not succeed as a musical theater song? And that is issue two, which is characterization. Because not every musical needs to have a traditional orchestra. There are tons of musicals that don't, right? Percy Jackson, Be More Chill, Heathers, like all of these, you know, more rocky, like modern, like teenage angst musicals, I would say. Death Note the musical. There are so many that sort of fall into that category. I'm obviously talking about the ones aimed at a more like teenage audience for a particular reason, but obviously there's also like more historical Broadway shows that have that as well. But one of the biggest lessons I learned in school is that music should be reactive to the character. But what is reactive music, and how is that any different from pop music? So I'm hoping that Disney doesn't come to my house, but if it's pitched up, that's because I had to do something for copyright. So let's talk about Poor Unfortunate Souls, because there are moments like this practically every 5 seconds, and so I want to give it a listen. So this is one of my favorites at the very beginning of the song.
You'll find that nowadays I've mended all my ways, repented, seen the light, and made a switch. Yes.
Okay, so that to start with, all right, we have this string thing, like, oh, I'm so good now, like the sort of, I don't know, harpsichord, it probably isn't, right? But like there's a choir music or like refined music element on like repented, seen the light, and made the switch. It's supposed to be like, oh yes, like how good I am, right? And then there's a slide on true, yes, and then this pause because she's not being honest, of course. And there's also a ding. So that is in the Broadway version, I think. And the ding after this, especially in musical theater, it's supposed to be a character getting an idea. So in that case, I think it's about Ursula continuing to think of ways to manufacture the lie. But even just in that phrase, you have the music reacting to the character. When Ursula's pretending to be good, there's sort of that choir again, or like, I'm, you know, a good person, right? I'm refined and good and like, you know, like I've seen the error of my ways. Pluck a little fancy harpsichord, right? And the true, yes, like that slide is Ursula being slippery, the ding, like all of those things are really, really good reactions in terms of the music is responding to what Ursula is saying. So let's keep listening because there's a couple other ones that I really, really like. And I did try to keep it mostly to the beginning of the song because we could be here literally all day looking at this. These songs are full of this sort of stuff. So let's listen now to the next one.
And I fortunately knew a little magic. It's a talent.
Yeah, so do you guys hear after magic, there's this
magic.
I don't know what that is, but the magical sound effect.
It's a talent that I always have possessed.
Even on possessed, there's like a flute. I think it's probably like flute section, you know, woodwind instrument after she says like it's a talent that I've always have possessed. The kind of twisty, like, woodwind instrument right there. There's another one I really like here. It's When I Help Them.
And do I help them? Yes, indeed.
It's those slides, right? It's those slides that are really, really reactive to what she's saying. And I help them slide, right? Because it's a lie, and then like, yes I do, and there's a bigger slide, and I just, oh, I love that stuff. That is what I really live for. One more.
And I'm afraid I had to rake them across the goals.
Okay, so with that one, it's this falling sequence in Rake Them Cross the Coals.
Yes, I've had the odd complaint, but on the whole, I've been a saint.
Obviously, the saint one is pretty obvious, right? Like, it has the choral, like, you know, again, the choir music. I think I have this one isolated, too. Couldn't pay the price. Yeah, so you can hear when it does cold, it goes do 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 do. Right, and the choir one is self-explanatory. So if you pay enough attention to every Disney villain song, even the hero songs, you will find a ton of moments like this. And I actually have more from Friends on the Other Side, because I do want to show that this is not just like, oh, it's just in the old Disney movies. Like, you can find it in the new Disney movies, too.
Don't you disrespect me, little man.
Okay, so with Dr. Facilier, it's really, really subtle, but when he gets mad, right, because the guy's like, oh, let's just move on. He's a confidence artist, right? Like, there's this, like, rattling noise. Yeah, it's way more prominent in this. They did a little shaky shake, which is really, really cool.
I can read your future.
There's a really haunting noise during I Can Read Your Future right there, and we'll listen to it isolated.
You have a soul known to learns. Make your wildest dreams come true.
So there's two things in there, right? There's wildest dreams come true being punctuated by the instruments, and there's also that, like, the spooky stuff that happens on I Can Change Your Future. So I do have an isolation for this, too. But yeah, I don't know if you guys can hear it that well, but there's a ooh, 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 ooh. Like, that's kind of what I mean by, like, the scary noise. Okay, so there's one more I want to show you just from Friends on the Other Side, again, close to the beginning.
The cards, the cards, the cards will tell. The past, the present, and the future as well.
So in there, you have this, like mystical noise, like when he's, like, having the cards go around, and then again, punctuated by the sound. This one makes it really obvious. Yeah, so that's really, really cool. And that's, like, Friends on the Other Side, again, is great for that. Mother Knows Best is one of the last ones we got, other than Shiny, and I've already played some Lin-Manuel Miranda, so I'm gonna take a look at some Mother Knows Best with you guys.
Still a little sapling, just a sprout.
Do you guys hear the woodwind instrument, or, like, the flute, or whatever it is? It's the thing that, like, kind of sounds like a bird, right? So that's on, like, sprouting, right? Like, the little, like, bird flying away, right? I mean, they say you want to leave the nest later, but that's also the growing sound. You know, the growing of a flower. Do-do-do-do. Like, that sort of thing, right?
Yes, I always knew this day was coming. Knew that soon you'd want to leave the nest.
Yeah, there's one in there. Do-do-do-do. Like, it's really, like, you know, fast. That instrumentation does it a little differently. It does it more like a harp sweeping upwards, but it's the same sort of concept. After sapling and want to leave the nest, it's the same thing. Okay, so let's talk about the ruffians fugs thing, because it is very, it's like very subtle, but it's still there, so let's listen. You can hear it a lot better, like doot doot. Doot doot, like, it's supposed to be like, oh no, like, you know, because she's saying all these scary things. It's like the equivalent of something musically jumping out at you. So this one's pretty self-explanatory. When she's trying to guilt trip Rapunzel, there's some very, like, sad violin. Yeah, so that one, you can just hear that one, right? I think the problem with the King song is that this doesn't really happen at all. The music does sort of cut out twice when he has this awkward laugh and he goes, oh, like, as if to rein himself back in, but the music itself isn't really reacting to what he's saying. It's just playing underneath him. There's, like, a spiral noise at one point that's like, oh, the King is coming unhinged sort of vibe. I found maybe 5 moments where I could be like, maybe something is happening here, right? Especially during the string section, because that's when he's getting unhinged. That's where it's happening. I found maybe 5 things in the entire song that are similar to that, but Poor Unfortunate Souls has 5 moments like that in the first 5 seconds, right? But, like, there's almost something like this after everything a character says, and these are the moments that I live for as someone who loves musical theater. Like, those are the moments that makes a song iconic and full of character. When you close your eyes, you can tell the difference between Ursula and Dr. Facilier. Like, those characters reflected in just the instrumental, they sound different. But how easily are people going to be able to differentiate this from any other pop song? Like, I can't prove that people wouldn't know it's from Wish. Like, I can't prove that this song is not going to be catchy, but to me, it just sounds like any other pop song, and part of that is the lack of reactions. You wouldn't know that a character is singing this as opposed to a real person, and that, to me, is a real problem. I may cut this out if the video gets too long, but if it's under 20 minutes, maybe I'll, you know, keep a little cheeky thing in. So I can't prove that people will not know the song, but I do have a little test that I came up with. I'm gonna play you two songs sung by the same character. If you're a Disney fan, only if you don't know the songs. Tell me what Disney animated franchise it belongs to, despite being either deleted, changed, or otherwise not in the original movie. So these are not in the original animated movies. I'm only pulling from the three big Renaissance movies, Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, and Aladdin, because they all have a musical theater and live action counterpart. Okay, so this is song one. Again, it's the same character. Okay, that's song one. This is song two. This is song one. This is the opening of song one. This is song two. This is song one. They almost sound like they could be spliced together. This is song two. This is song one. This is song two. This is the ending of song two. The ending of song one. Okay, I think that's enough for now. So the Beast is one of the only characters that has two different solo songs and other material, despite not even having a solo in the movie that he originates from. And now, I just may be a fanatic, I may just be crazy, but to me, these clearly sound like Beast songs, okay? It lifts the leitmotif from the beginning of the movie, right when you first see the castle, the do-do-do-do-do-do-do, like that whole thing is at the beginning of the movie. But I feel like that even if I didn't tell you it was the same character, you would be able to know that. Like, you would be able to listen to these songs in relation to each other and see that they both share similar thematic or similar composition elements. And I tried to put the similar elements side by side so you can sort of hear that technique being used. But a couple of things, other than the leitmotif, are those sort of, like, fast violins especially, and just, like, how the trumpets are building. Like, the Beast music has a magical quality, sort of like that, like, Ursula thing that I talked about earlier, that magical noise. It has the idea that the petal is falling at the very start. And then you have this dark, hopeless, foreboding. And if you've seen Beauty and the Beast and didn't know those songs, I bet that you can at least tell that you know that they're the Beast, right? I bet that you can at least tell that they're the Beast songs as opposed to Belle or Cogsworth or whoever, right? Because this just sounds so much like how the Beast feels. If the King song was in an instrumental pop music playlist, would people be able to differentiate it from any other pop song? Is there anything in here that conveys that this is the King? Maybe it's too early to tell because we haven't seen the movie, but I just don't think so. When I hear the song, especially the instrumental, it's really damning that this just sounds like a pop song, and there's nothing specific to this character. There's nothing that invokes the King as opposed to a pop artist. You know what I mean? Like, even I think through pop artists, you can tell when a pop song is in a certain artist's style. But I feel like that when you're writing for musical theater, it's not just about your style, it's about the character's style. You kind of have to imagine, like, if the character wrote the song, how would they make it sound? And so I feel like that, in turn, it makes it feel less like a musical theater number, because this convention of reactive music, or having music that is based on the character's feelings to this extent, it's very specific to musical theater, and that is not present here. It doesn't give, like, oh, this is only the King's song and the King alone. Right, when I listen to this, I will forever know that that is the Beast, especially again with that iconic leitmotif that happens when you first see the castle, right? I just know that it's the Beast song, and I could listen to a bunch of other stuff that Alan Menken has composed, and I will know and be able to differentiate that this is the Beast song. But in terms of the King, I don't think that there's anything really in here that makes me feel like, oh, this is even a Disney song, right? There's nothing in here that makes it feel like a Disney song, never mind that it's specifically from the King. Like, you could have, if you recorded a version that was a completely different character singing it, that I think is really the key. If you recorded a version of the song and had a different character sing it, not knowing the context of the movie, would you be able to know that that version is incompatible with the character? Like, if you had Belle sing this, that you would know that something's not completely right here, right? But if they kind of did, like, you know, some sort of test, some sort of, fake version where they had, like, a different character, like, say the Queen. If they had the Queen sing this, you wouldn't be able to know, no, like, that's not the Queen song. The Queen isn't like this, right? Like, and maybe, again, that's just because we don't know the characters yet, but I feel like that you could interchange here. There could be interchangeable characters. Like, you cannot just slap this Beast song on any other Disney villain. It doesn't fit. So the fact that you could potentially put the King song on any pop artist or any character in the movie, again, that's my argument, that's what I think, I don't think that that's a very good sign here. So issue one in my eyes is the lack of traditional orchestra pit. The band makes it sound like more of a pop song, but this is only heightened by the second issue, which is that this song is not reacting to the characters at all like traditional Disney songs do. And this, in turn, makes it feel less like a musical theater number because that convention is specific to musical theater, and that's just not present. There's only one more thing I want to talk about, and that is the sense of tradition in general. I think how the movie was marketed probably played into a lot of the audience expectations, because a lot of people saw Wish as, like, return to form. Right? Especially because of the marketing. You're combining 3D with 2D effect, all the references to previous Disney movies, like I already said, like Asha, the fairy godmother, Snow White, her friends being the seven dwarfs. Even in the King song, there's like a reference to the evil queen, like he loves looking at himself in the mirror, and I wonder if that's supposed to be evil queen sort of coded, I don't know, right? And so this movie is being partially marketed on, this is ode to Disney, right? This is what Disney's about, wishes, dreams for its 100th anniversary. Even in the short that they released for the 100th anniversary, you have Asha holding hands and singing with Snow White. It's supposed to be a full circle moment. So when the movie marketing points back to, we're going back to our roots, we're going back full circle, I think of course people are gonna be taken aback when the villain song does not represent or reflect that, because as I said, Broadway talent is what made Disney music so iconic. Theater is what made Disney music so iconic. But how can you have an iconic Disney musical without theater? It is not musical theater. Like, you know what I mean? It's not just musical. It's musical theater. The idea of theatrics. And how can you do that without that style of music? And as I mentioned, other Disney movies have done this. You have Brave, Tarzan. I know Toy Story is Pixar, but let's just throw them in there. Lilo and Stitch, Brother Bear. Like, there was sort of an era where this was popular, especially like the Brother Bear and the Tarzan and all that stuff. Like Phil Collins was the Lin-Manuel Miranda, you know, and he was in all of these movies, right? But I wouldn't say that those movies are musical. They are movies that include music with lyrics. And so by comparison, I feel like that this may be a musical in terms of the medium for telling a story, but musical theater is not only a medium, like I said, it's a style. And so this is what makes things really muddy for me, because it's giving jukebox musical, okay? And I will say, I don't like pop music. I don't know if you guys can tell, I don't find the compositions interesting or reactive to the singer, so I don't really like them. Not all pop music is like that, but that's why I don't listen to pop music, because I don't find anything interesting. It's very repetitive. I remember actually in school, we had to sing a pop song, and so I sung this very complex pop song from one of my favorite Japanese artists, but they had sung it in English, right? And so I sung this song and we had to write a report on it, and my report was like 10 pages because there was so much like lyric analysis and this like reactive like music that changed based off of the lyrics that she was singing. Like, it was just such a, you know, an intense song, and it meant a lot to me. The complexity meant a lot to me. There was a rap section but also a singing section. Like, vocally it was challenging, lyrically it was super complex, and then also like in the actual instrumentation there were all these like little things that I guess described or reacted to, and my teacher was like, this is like a master's essay, like this is like grad school like report, but couldn't you pick something next time where you don't have to think as much? And I was like, why? Like, what a thing to say. What a thing to imply that pop music is supposed to be thoughtless and just fun. It's just for fun. Pick something where you don't need to think, right? And I don't like that. I don't want something that has no thought in it, because I feel like that it just has no heart in that sense, right? Like with, you know, Ursula's song and Dr. Facilier and all the examples that I used, you can see the heart in it because there are all these little moments that show this understanding of the character. Why do I want to listen to something just for fun, just thoughtless? Like, for me, the fun is that stuff, because you can see the composer taking such care in there. And I think what was really damning about this was I showed my mom this song because I was telling her what I was doing, and she thought it was the celebrity version. Like the version at the end of the Disney movie when the credits roll, you know? Like, I don't know, the Celine Dion version of Beauty and the Beast or whatever? Like, and I think that's bad! Like, am I the only one who doesn't think that's good for somebody to listen to a song that's supposed to be in a musical movie and be like, well, that's a celebrity version, right? Like, that's a celebrity version. That's not the real version. That's a pop version. That's like Imagine Dragons at the end of Frozen. No, that's not what should be happening, right? Something else that we learned in school was that it's important for your song to be about one thing. And I feel like that was more like structure and lyrics. Like, you don't want the song to be muddled, and so you want to make sure that it's doing one thing. And it's really hard to sort of explain that without an example of a song that doesn't do that, but like, think about Poor Unfortunate Souls again. It's just about getting Ariel to sign the contract. It's like just about her contract with Ariel. That's what it's about. It's about that one thing. And so that was more when you're songwriting. But on a meta level, I still feel like this rule applies, because, you know, on one hand, there's a foot in pop. And I'm gonna say this with absolutely no evidence, but maybe the idea that, like, oh, we need to appeal to the masses, right? We need to appeal to a mass audience, right? We need to appeal to the people that don't like musicals, maybe, right? And then on the other hand, you're marketing this as a musical. And so there's no attempt to marry these things together. And so I think that you're gonna lose, at the end of the day, both people on that front. And I'm not gonna say, like, oh, it's not like the movie's gonna flop because of this or anything, but in terms of, I'm not gonna listen to this song, I'm not gonna be very happy when I, like, hear this song in the theater, right? I'm not gonna replay this song. Someone like my sister, who really likes pop music, isn't gonna play this song because it's from a Disney movie. You know? And so in the attempt to appeal to everyone, how many people are you gonna lose? And I feel like that's an interesting question. That's why you have to make a choice. You have to make a decision, right? And I feel like that this gives the vibe that no decision was really made. There is a way to move forward and have modern musical theater music without it losing what makes it musical theater. And, you know, as much as the Lin-Manuel Miranda slander went on, I feel like that if he was, you know, if he had written the music, it would sound like a good blend of modern and musical theater and have the brass, fun, jazzy instruments that I'm missing, right? And so I'm still excited to see the movie. Like, I just want to make that really clear. I'm not trying to hate without reason. I'm not saying that it's gonna flop, but it's not catchy pop music that made Disney animated movies so iconic. It was creating a Broadway number within an animated musical with Broadway composers and most of the time sung by Broadway talent, or at least people who had been trained with the intention of Broadway to some extent. And I think that there's just a way to move forward without disregarding that fact, because like Frozen was able to do that, Moana was able to do that, Encanto was able to do that, but I don't think the problem is that Wish can't do that, it's that Wish doesn't want to. And I sort of just wonder why, and I hope that this isn't a bad omen for future Disney animated movies, because there's so much potential and so many amazing young composers that would absolutely, you know, kill for the opportunity, and they would do such a good job. But just sad. It's just sad to give that opportunity to a pop artist, I feel. But in conclusion, if you don't really like the songs and you can't necessarily articulate why, maybe this is the reason. At least this is the reason why I think I don't like them, okay? I wanted to lay it out in a more constructive way than being like, oh, I don't like it, it sounds like Imagine Dragons or whatever. Like, I wanted to actually do a deep dive and be like, the song isn't bad, but for what it's trying to accomplish, like, this is maybe the problem, or what other songs accomplished in the past, this is where it doesn't measure up. And maybe some of you have an interest in writing a musical theater song, or, you know, selecting good audition material. Like, I feel like that song that is composed well also falls into something you should think about when you're going to an audition. And so I think that this can be a helpful benchmark to see if the music you create, or if the music you choose, is able to capture those elements effectively. So this has been Calxiyn, caring way too much. And I'll see you all next time. Bye, everybody.